Hi guys, Nick Jennison for Guitar Interactive. Freshly shorn, as you can see, it is my winter haircut. We're talking about wigs in the comment section already, and I couldn't help but have a little bit of a chuckle to myself. We'll get onto that in just a moment. Thank you very much for joining us for yet another Monday guitar live stream, where we do the thing we like to do on Mondays, which is hang out and talk about the guitar. I'd like to do it every day, to be completely frank with you guys, pun intended, but Monday nights are becoming a highlight of my week. I do like myself a little bit of live stream action with you guys. So today we're continuing our series on picking strategies, where we talk about the picking approaches used by the great guitar masters. I've picked some people, pun intended, very, very deliberately to demonstrate a few of the different picking schools out there. So far, we've taken a look at Zach Wilde, we've taken a look at Yngwie Malmsteen, we've taken a look at John Petrucci, and today I'm throwing myself into the deep end and we're taking a look at the godfather of economy picking, Frank Gambale, says so down here. So it must be true. I had the pleasure of meeting Frank a few nams ago. Really great guy, phenomenal player in the flesh, just absolutely outrageous command of the instrument. And we're going to see if we can get a little bit of that into your guitar playing today. But before we do that, let's check in with the stream, see how everyone's doing, and I'm going to tell you a little bit about a special offer that we're running for your GI Plus membership. So first of all, wig or without? Well, Tin Man Tin, apparently today I am without wig. So there you go. Joe Stump has the wig, according to David Yates. You can tell that Richard, I think I made this same comment last stream. I read this immediately as Dorian Yates. Spent too much time in the gym, apparently. So there you go. iSteve is tuning in, says, hello, everyone. Blue Sumlin, friend of the stream, says, hi, Nick and everyone. Blue Sumlin, it's great to have you. Marcin is joining us in the stream, says, all aboard. Marcin, it is great to have you. Blue Sumlin, says Frank Gambale, one of the best economy pickers ever. I absolutely wholeheartedly agree with this. For my money, probably the forefather of modern economy picking styles. So a big name in terms of picking strategies. And we're going to be able to deduce some cool stuff about Frank's strategy as we go forward. Hopefully some stuff that we can you guys can use in your own playing. Who else do we have? Timothy Appling says Florida Keys here, tuning in from sunny Florida. Hopefully it's warmer over there than it is in the UK. It is freezing cold. Mark McNish is tuning in from a cold and sunny Idaho. Incidentally, if you're joining us for the first time or you're a regular viewer, drop us a comment, let us know where you're tuning in from. We would love to hear from you. Now, I have another Guitar Interactive magazine. Our team are saying, enjoy the stream, drop us a like, and you won't break a string for a year. That is 100% true, and if you don't forward that on to six of your friends, you'll break six strings on your next gig. Stefano is tuning in from Italy. Great to have you on board, my man. Thank you so much for joining us. Let me tell you a little bit about an offer that we're running. So because you guys have been like super, super receptive to the content we've been putting out in these streams, we wanted to open up a special offer for GI Plus memberships. So what we're doing is we are running an exclusive offer for 50% off your annual membership, which will run throughout the stream, and it will run 1 hour after this stream is done. So live viewers, you get the special offer, 50% off your annual membership. If you're watching this on the repeat, I do apologize, but we will be running some special offers kind of going forward. So if you want to get in on that crazy offer that we can't possibly repeat too often, otherwise we'll go bankrupt, then you know what to do. There will be links in the description, links in the comments, probably most likely in the comments in this stream on whatever platform you're watching it on, most likely on YouTube too, and that is going to be available for you guys for 1 full hour after the conclusion of this stream. So if you want to get on that, I would get on that quickly. So a quick word about GI Plus. Let's talk a little bit about what you get in your GI Plus membership. We talked about some tech sessions. We have tech sessions for Zach Wilde. We have tech sessions for Yngwie Malmsteen, John Petrucci, and like so many other great guitar players. We also have exclusive lesson content from the likes of myself, Sam Bell, Phil Short. Who else do we have? Andy James, Andy Wood, Chris Buck, all of the aforementioned, and so many more. I'll tell you more about that in a moment. The logo is up here. You get all of that, including the membership, and we're adding so much more stuff all the time. It's free backing tracks. We're going to be running some free webinars too in the new year, so you're really not going to want to miss this little offer. So let's get stuck in with the Frank Gambale picking strategy. Now, my man Frank is known primarily as an economy picker. Now, interestingly, Frank doesn't actually call it economy picking. He just calls it sweet picking. An economy picking is kind of an epithet that's being put on Frank's style after the fact. But what I want you guys to do, you guys who are watching us, drop something in the comments and let us know what you think economy picking means. So I'm going to play a little bit. I'm going to go to the close-up camera. I'm going to change tracks for just a little bit, and we'll try and do something a little bit less fusion-tastic. And I'm going to maybe pop the Richie Kotzen backing track on. That might be good fun. Let's try that one. I'm going to play for a little bit, and I want you guys to let me know in the comments, what does economy picking mean to you? What do you think it means? And then I'll just tell you what I think it means, and then we'll talk about how Frank employs this for his absolutely ludicrous playing style. Let's try this. Here we go. Knock that up a little bit more. The track's pretty low. Let's just bump that up a little higher. There we That seems a good place any to end it. So we've got at least a couple of decent answers in the comments already. Do let me know what you guys think though. So drop me a line, let me know what's going on in terms of your thoughts on economy picking, and I'll tell you what I think is actually going down here. So Marcine is saying, Yngwie says he doesn't do sweeps. So I guess we should create a new term, Ferrari picking. I am down for that. And I think Yngwie would probably be down for that too, to be completely honest. Anything with that prancing horse on, I think he's all about. David Yates is a really good comment. I use economy picking ascending with odd notes, but I really do need to spend some time practicing descending. I'm totally pants in that direction. We're going to see if we can fix that for you tonight, David. So stay put, because there is a simple optimization that we can make to your playing that may make all of the difference in the world. Adrian says, economy picking is the minimization of motion via specific pick strokes at string transitions, down after down, up after us. Cheers from Romania. That is actually a very, very good definition. Timothy Appling says, the art of playing all the notes without picking each note and using hammer-ons, pull-offs, and bends to achieve the sound. That is a very economical way of playing, Timothy, but that's something that I would possibly refer to as legato style playing. So that's something different. Bobby T says, any advantages of using economy, disadvantages of using economy over alternate? Seems like it could be easier overall, but I'm no expert. There are pros and cons to each approach, and I will tell you a little bit about those in a moment. So we're going to go with Adrian's definition here, because Adrian's definition is great. That is a very good definition of what economy picking is, but let's see if we can drill it down just a little bit further. We're going to go to the potato quality right-hand cam, and I'm going to show you a line. I do apologize, but I've had to reserve my two good cameras for the fretboard cam and the main cam. So you're going to have to deal with this potato camera down here, but it's all good. So, for example, if we took a very simple line, let's just take a symmetrical pattern. Let's take a symmetrical pattern that is going to run. Let's go to this camera while I show you. And if you guys don't have your guitars, by the way, grab your guitars because you can try this along with us, right? So I'd love to hear your results. If you don't have a guitar, do come and grab one. So we'll take a symmetrical line that goes like this. We're going to play 11, 12, and 14 on the A string. We'll play that on the D string, the G string, and the B string. And then we'll get this. Now you'll notice that you can't see my picking hand there, so let's go to the picking hand cam and let me show you what's going on there. Now with traditional alternate picking, what we would do here is we would play down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up. An economy picking approach would be to essentially minimize the amount of outside pick strokes that we're using. Try and get rid of outside pick strokes if we can. Now, what does that mean? Well, an outside pick stroke is where you would play, for example, with a downstroke on the A string and then an upstroke on the D string. So let me tell you that one more time. Downstroke on the A string, upstroke on the D string. What that means is the pick is having to travel from the outside of one string pair to the other side on the outside of another string pair. By contrast, an inside pick stroke would be an up pick on the A string and a down pick on the D string. So we're trying to get rid of those. And the way we get rid of those is by using sweeps in just the right places. So what we might do is we might play with this particular picking line. Instead of playing down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, we would play down, up, down, play with the volume on, down, up, down, and allow our pick to rest on the next string. So you can see that there, my pick is resting on the D string. So once again, down, up, down, and rest. This rest is quite important. And then we'll play with a sweep, down, up, down, and rest on the next string. Down, up, down, and rest on the next string. Down, up, down, and rest on the next string. Now, the eagle-eyed among you who've been following these picking strategy streams will notice that that is an approach that we've has been used by another one of the players we've studied. It is the Yngwie Malmsteen ascending approach. So the Malmsteen ascending approach runs this. Thusly, in terms of Malmsteen's world, what we get is if there are... We start every string with a downstroke, and if there is an even number of notes on a string, such as two or four, we just pick them. So if we had four notes, we would get this. Down, up, down, up. If we had four notes on every string, we would get all alternate picking, and that would be fine. But in the Yngwie world, if we have an odd number of notes on a string, such as three, we would play down, up, down, and then sweep. Up, down, sweep, up, down, sweep, up, down, sweep, up, down. So we've described Yngwie's approach as being an asymmetrical picking approach. Asymmetrical, because Yngwie uses, and this is where David Yates' comment is really interesting, use economy picking ascending on odd notes. Now that is exactly what Yngwie does, because you can't really use economy picking on even groups of notes. It has to be alternate picking, because that's just the nature of the pick strokes. You can't go down, up, down, up, and then sweep to a string that's below. If you have two strings there, you can't go down, up, down, up, and expect to sweep onto this string. It doesn't really work. That is what we'd call an alternate pick approach. You can use it to change direction, but that's something for another story. So you can't sweep in one direction with an odd number of notes, even number of notes, rather, on a string. That's something Frank talks about. Now, Yngwie's style is asymmetrical because Yngwie is what we'd call a one-way pickslander, or a single escape player, or an upstroke escape player. Lots of words, they all basically mean the same thing. What it boils down to is that Yngwie would play with this picking posture. If you look into the main cam real quick, you'll notice that this forearm bone up here is off, up in the air. It's not in contact with the guitar's body. This bone, this ulnar bone right here, is in contact with the guitar's body. The radius is not. This means that upstrokes pull away from the guitar's body, downstrokes bury into the strings, and that means that if we're playing lines that end with an upstroke, like a down, up, down, up, we are clear, and we can transition to the next string. We're clear. Now here, because we played three notes, play it again, we have to sweep. So the Yngwie approach is an asymmetrical approach because he does this in the ascending direction, but never really makes the jump to full economy picking because he doesn't flip this style and do its mirror version in the ascending direction, which is what our man David is talking about with his comment here. So let me show you what I'm talking about there. So if we took the same line, the same three note line, and we played it ascending, then descending, this idea of playing 11, 12, and 14 on the A string, D string, G string, B string, like this, We could play it in this direction using Yngwie's style, but it would be very difficult to play it in this direction. So what Yngwie would do is he would keep his hand posture and play down, up, pull off, down, up, pull off, down, up, pull off, down, up, pull off. What Frank does is he takes the Yngwie ascending style and inverts it. So what I mean by invert that is he would play, if we did the descending version, he would play up, down, up, and then sweep on an upstroke to get the next string. Up, down, up, up, down, up, up, down, up. Now, notice the posture of my right hand when I do this. Watch this. Here's the Yngwie approach. Notice the posture doesn't change. Here is the Gambale approach. Watch the posture. Notice that the posture had to flip. It had to flip, and that is the crucial part of the Gambale style. And that's why we've chosen to do Gambale as a follow-up to the Yngwie style, because it's essentially Yngwie's ascending picking approach, but flipped on its head for descent. Now, in terms of the posture that we flip to, what we get is this. We take the radius bone of the forearm, we keep it there, but we put the, sorry, keep the ulna bone, which is this one here. We take the radius and we put that in contact with the guitar's body as well. So we have two bones in contact with the guitar's body now. You'll notice this kind of cocks the wrist out a little bit, and that's fine. Just look at that. Please, Sumlin says, flick of the wrist. Yep, absolutely. It's a little flick of the wrist, a trick of the wrist. So we're going to put it there. And what we get now is we get a posture where downstrokes will pull away from the guitar's body and upstrokes will bury into the plane of the strings. Now, this is important because, take a look at this. If we're going to sweep from, let's say we're going to sweep from the B string to our G string, what we want is we want the upstroke, that's going to be this sweeping direction here, we want that to essentially rest against the G string once we've played the notes on the B string. So now what we have is this posture that enables us to change after downstrokes. So we could play up, down, up, down, and be perfectly clear to change onto the string on the next pick stroke. And there we go. Or we could play with our sweeping kind of strategy. Now, this is the surface of Gambale's picking approach, but this is kind of the beginning of it, right? This is the very beginning of it. Now, what it opens the door for us to do, which is something that's very, very difficult to do with alternate picking styles, is it gives us the opportunity to play very few notes on a string. And what I mean by this is playing one note, two notes, something like that, very, very few, or very small clusters of notes on a string. Here's a challenge for you guys. Here's a challenge. Ah, here we go. Joel Hume has said, so you switch from downward to upward pick slanting depending upon the direction, right? Absolutely correct. This is an approach that you might call directional pick slanting. Directional pick slanting. So directional pick slanting is the idea that you essentially lean in the direction of the pick's travel. So if you're ascending, you lean in this direction. If you're descending, you lean in this direction. And it's something that people find quite natural. It's some people do anyway. Personally, I found this quite natural, and this was the first picking style that I really got to grips with. Personally, this was something that was a bit of a breakthrough for me. And this highlights the importance, by the way, of not necessarily having to be a master of all of these picking strategies. You just pick one that works for you, or you find one that works for you. That's why we're going over all of them. Find one that works for you, and then you kind of roll with that. So here's a challenge for you guys. Grab your guitars. I want to know how you find these particular licks. I'm going to give you two, right? Let's do two. Let's go to our fourth position. So we're going to play with a very symmetrical fingering position. Play it nice and easy. Let's try playing on the A string. We'll play 4, 5, 7. Then on the D string, we'll just play 5. And then on the G string, we're going to play 4, 5, 7 again. So we get this. Now, what I want to know from you guys is, do you find this easier with alternate picking, which would be like this? Or do you find it easier with this economy style approach? If that makes sense. So I want to know which one you find easier. I'm going to throw a backing track on, and we'll try, or rather I'll just throw a drum loop on. In fact, let's do a drum loop. So here's my drums. I'm going to throw this on. I'm going to play this. I want you guys to play it with me. So here it is, alternate picking. Here it is, economy picking. So, I don't know how you feel about it, but for me, it's pretty easy to get this stuff up to speed using this economy picking approach. The reason for this is, first of all, your pick doesn't have to move that far. So we know that speed is kind of distance over time, if that makes sense. So if you reduce the amount of distance you have to travel a little bit, it's easy to get that going a little bit faster. Yeah, Blue Summerlin summed this up. Less effort, economy picking. Yeah. I'm guessing that's a response to the question. Yeah, less effort for economy picking. Absolutely, right? So I would wholeheartedly agree with this sort of stuff. Now, if we start expanding this out and start doing some licks that have multiple single strings, like something like this, for example, let's try playing something like this. That's quite good fun. There's loads of ways we can play that. I'm going to show you guys what it is, and then we'll talk about how you might finger it. So this lick is going to be essentially an E, kind of sus2, sus4 arpeggio. The way we're going to get it, don't worry too much about that. It's kind of a cool sounding E major arpeggio, basically. So what we get is we start on the 7th fret on the A string. If we play 7, 9, and then 12... And then we play across 9, 9, 9, and then we get on the high string 12, 7. I want to play something else there, but that's totally fine. Now that is a line that is very, very hard to play with alternate picking. Let me show you. I'm going to throw a backing track on in E major. Let's do our ambient ballad. Incidentally, all these backing tracks are available on the Guitar Interactive YouTube channel. So if you want to get hold of them, you can do that easy enough. Let me chuck this on. I'll show you that lick one more time. So what we're going to get is on the A string, 7, 9, 12, then 9, 9, 9 across the D string, G string, B string, then 12 and 7 again on the end. Played alternate picking, nightmare. Very hard indeed. With economy picking, much easier, much, much easier. My instincts are wanting to phrase that slightly differently, but this is part of the majesty of Frank's style. Is it essentially enables us to play an absolutely, completely arbitrary number of notes on a string, including one. Now, one note on a string is traditionally very, very hard with alternate picking. And this is not something that is the case with economy picking. So when we get into this economy picking style of playing, if we talk about the pick strokes that are going on there, if we take a look at our close-up camera from the right hand, what we have is we have down, up, down, 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 up, down. Really nothing to it. One more time. Now, in terms of actual pick movements, watch what's going on in terms of the movements of my wrist and how many there are. We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 movements, 5 pick strokes, one of which is just a big long drag across the strings. If I play it with alternate picking, I have to change directions. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. five, six, seven, eight times, as opposed to five times. And I also have to traverse those strings. I have to get this curved picking path that is very traditionally very challenging. Really easy to do this with this economy picking style. So that is another benefit of this Gambale approach. And of course, it works in the opposite direction too. So if we took the same lick and we reversed it, so let's maybe try playing 12-7. Let's try that. That feels pretty good. Let me show you that close up. So let's try playing 12, 7, 9, 9, 9, 9 all the way across, and then 12, 7 on the bottom. So once more, 12, 7, 9's across on four strings, 12, 7. What we get now is this. That is a nightmare to play with. Alternate picking, surprisingly easy to play with economy picking. Let's throw it into our ballad. Let's throw you through what I'm talking about. Now, something you'll see quite a lot in Frank's playing are these little clusters of a handful of notes in a string, and then maybe just one note on another couple of strings. So an example of that might be something like this, or you might get. Oop. Rhymes with keyboard in there for a second. They're all a product of this picking approach. Now, there is another facet to Frank's playing that I think is a bit of a red herring. Personally, I think this is a bit of a red herring. But what Frank talks about in some of his kind of like real seminal videos on the subject is the idea that odd numbers of notes change direction. Now, this is true to an extent, but I think that's something people get caught up in and it's not necessarily super useful. So an example of that would be if Frank was playing a scale line, which would be something maybe like this. Maybe we'll take an E major scale like this. You can tell I'm used to playing certain lines here. But that's an interesting one. So what we're dealing with there is we're dealing with a major scale shape in the key B. We've got frets 7, 9, 11, 7, 9, 11. And then rather 8, 9, and 11. What Frank talks about is the idea of using an even number of notes on a string to change direction. So what you might find is you might find you would play an odd number of notes on a string like this. And when it's time to change direction, you would phrase in such a way that there's an even number of notes on a string. So what that would be something like this, where we'd get 1, 2, 4, 1. As our fingering numbers. Now, traditionally, we'd expect to play this to turn our scale around, but what Frank would do is miss one of those notes out or add another note in with maybe a chromatic passage to flip the picking around. So if you watch my right hand, what we get here is down, up, down, sweep, up, down, sweep, up, down, up, and notice that I've changed posture. I'm now resting on the D string, ready to continue my way back down. Now, that is something that can be useful when you're putting together some bigger economy picking lines and so on and so forth, but it's not a hard and fast rule, so don't get too caught up in that. I think that is a bit of a red herring. I think that's something that is, it can be useful, but I think a better way of thinking about it is to take the Malmsteen approach, which is if you kind of come across an even number of notes on a string, you can just alternate pick them. So if I was doing that, for example, what I might get with my change of direction is I might get I could sweep there, that'd be fine. But if I wanted to keep going, I could just alternate pick those lines. That would work. That would work just fine. Whereas in the Gambale rule system, that would have to switch direction. It'd have to switch direction because that's the rules that he's kind of laid out for himself. Incidentally, these are rules that Frank doesn't actually follow all of the time, which is why I think it's a red herring. I think he's put that out there as an educational thing, but I don't think he does it all the time himself. So I wouldn't necessarily worry about this whole business of odd numbers of notes changing direction. So let's sum this up in the briefest possible terms. What we essentially have is we have a pick slant that follows the direction of the pick's travel. So if we're ascending, we lean in this direction. Boop. If we are descending, we lean in this direction. Now, in those particular picking slants, what we'll do, we'll start with the ascending direction, which is the same as the Malmsteen one. If we have an odd number of notes on a string, we sweep. If we have an even number of notes on a string, we alternate pick. And because of the posture of the pick, neither of these is a problem, because we're leaning in this direction with this bone up in the air so that the upstrokes will always escape. All we do in the descending direction is flip it on its head. So instead of starting every string on a downstroke, we start every string on an upstroke. We greet every string with an upstroke in this direction. And what we do is if we have an odd number of notes, we sweep. If we have an even number of notes, we alternate pick. Let's put this into practice. Here's a line for you guys to play around with. So let's take, very, very quickly, let's take a symmetrical scale shape. Once again, we're going to do this 1-2-4 fingering pattern. Let's try playing that across all six strings. Let's try playing 1-2-4, that's frets 4-5-7, on the lowest two strings. Then we'll play fingers 1-2-3-4 on the middle two strings. Then we're going to play 1-2-4 on the outside strings. In the ascending direction, what we get is this. Alternate pick that. Let's go like this. Now, what this will result in is a pick structure that looks like this. We get down, up, down, we're resting, so we can sweep. Down, up, down, we're resting. Here we go, down, up, and we're fine. Down, up, and we're fine. Down, and we're stuck, so we sweep. Down, up, down. Easy. In the reverse, which would be 4-2-1, 4-2-1, 4-3-2-1, 4-3-2-1, 4-2-1, 4-2-1. So three notes on this string, three notes on this string, four notes on these strings, three notes on these strings. What we get instead is we would get up, down, up, up, down, up. Once again, up, down, up, up, down, up, up, down, up, down. And notice we're up in the air, so we're fine. Up, down, up in the air, so we're fine. Up, down, up, and now we're stuck, but that's okay because we can sweep. And that is, in a nutshell, the Gambale picking strategy. In a nutshell, it's what you might call economy picking, but probably a better way to think about it is maybe directional picking. It's probably a way to think about it, because it's not strict economy picking in the sense that you must always find ways to economy pick. Now, if you've ever seen Frank do any alternate picking stuff, he's a master at this sort of thing. People talk about, oh, Frank Gambale, he's the economy picking guy. Frank is an absolutely outrageous, tremendous alternate picker as well. So we have some of that baked into this strategy. That is handy because there are times when you're going to need it. The beauty of this, like I say, is it lets you play absolutely arbitrary amounts of notes on a string, which is not something that you can do using most of the picking strategies. So let me show you these lines once again with the drum loop. Here's our drums. Let's go to the close-up camera. And I'm going to the right-hand close-up camera. So what we get is, in fact, let's go to the left-hand close-up camera. You can still see my right hand here. So what we would get in the ascending direction, and then in the descending direction, we would get, so I want to know from you guys, if this feels easy enough to you or if it feels totally alien. Let me know in the comments, drop me a line, let me know. I would love to hear. Once again, this is the ascending direction. Descending. A little faster. Mess there. again, this is just one way to skin the cat. There's so many ways that you can approach this stuff. This is only one of them. So as a reminder, there's been a whole bunch of possible options here. We have someone like Zach Wilde, who has a very symmetrical but one-directional picking strategy, and will organize his lines in such a way that upstrokes escape and lines finish on upstrokes. We have someone like Yngwie, who is an asymmetrical half economy picker, half like pick and legato cheat, for want of a better word, but there's no cheating in music. If it sounds good, that's all there is to it. We also have someone like John Petrucci, who is a true two-way double escape alternate picking player, and that comes with its own set of challenges because in Petrucci's playing we have a bias towards a particular pick slant, and then he'll just dip his toe into the other one. For some players, they have the same bias but in the opposite direction. And now we have the fourth and possibly final strategy, which is this economy picking strategy. The question as to which one is best for you is a question that only you can answer. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to play for a little bit, and because we have so many great questions in the comments already, we're going to be taking some more questions. So do me a favor, let me know what you want to know. Drop your questions in the comments. We will answer them in the Q&A. I would like to know a few things from you guys too. I'd like to know, first of all, if you've made any particular progress across these live streams. I know some of you have. If you've made any progress or had any breakthroughs with your playing during these live streams, let me know. Also, I'd like to know from you guys what your personal picking strategy is. What do you lean towards? I will tell you mine probably after this. I think I'll play a little bit and then I'll tell you what mine's all about, because I don't want to kind of influence you guys too much. I want to know what your picking strategy is. And a reminder, if you didn't join us at the start of the stream, if you're just tuning in, a quick reminder, we are doing a special offer where you can get 50% off your annual GI Plus membership, GI Plus being the exclusive lesson platform from Guitar Interactive Magazine. You can get that at the link that we've posted in the comments. It's going to be available to you for 1 hour after the conclusion of this stream, and that's it. No more. We'll be taking it down after an hour. So if you want to get hold of this crazy deal that we're never going to repeat, probably never going to repeat anyway, it's just like bonkers. I don't even know where this deal came from, but I'm all about it. I want to get you guys on board. So if you want to get hold of that deal, there is a link where you can get hold of it. It will be available to you for 1 hour after the conclusion of this stream. If you're watching this in the playback, apologies, the offer will have expired, but we also have great offers that we run all the time, so check out GI Plus all the same. I'm gonna play a little bit, we're gonna take some questions, so drop me your questions in the comments down there. I'll play, I'm gonna show you some just general noodling about, let's say, some general mindless noodling, and why not, because we're just exploring our picking here. We're not about writing the next day with heaven, we're just, you know, exploring the way picking works. Maybe I'll do some more musical stuff another time. But I'm going to play a little bit. I'm going to explore the various picking strategies that I tend to use. Drop me your questions in the comments, and I will see you on the flip side of this short jamlet. Here we go. A petty jam. Here we go. We'll be right back. fun. So we've got some great questions coming in. If you want to get hold of these backing tracks, by the way, once again, you can get them on the Guitar Interactive YouTube channel. They're available for free. If you want to watch them ad-free, if you want to watch them without any adverts, let's see, you're not a YouTube premium subscriber. If you'd like to watch them ad-free, you can do so at GI Plus. You don't even need to be a member to watch them ad-free. You can go to GA Plus, you can access them. Even if you are not a member, you can watch them ad-free. Members get to keep the backing tracks as well, by the way. You can download them from the GI Plus site. That's available for you every time we load a new backing track. It is, it's there for you. So, we've got some great questions. So, let's get stuck in. Let's get stuck right in with the Q&A. How's that for a transition? So, Q&A, let's get into the questions from the comment section. If you have questions, we're still accepting them, by the way. So let me know. Drop me a line in the comments. Let me know what you think. Let's see. Let's start way back up the top because we've got so many good ones. Let's see. Embry Smith, what's with the endless noodling? It's picking, man. We're trying to explore some picking strategies. I'm not trying to compose the next Autumn Leaves. I'm not sure I could have tried. Anyway, here we go. So let's get into it. So, good question from Bobby T, 1992. Any disadvantages to using economy over alternate? Seems like it would be easy overall, but I'm no expert. Now, I find personally, and this is just me, I find personally, it can be easy to lose your time feel with economy picking. It's just one of those things. If you're playing alternate picking, you have this down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, rigid kind of time thing going on, which is a little easier to keep the... It's a little easier to keep your licks in time. You have to pay a little more attention when it comes to playing stuff in time with economy picking, especially if you have the sort of lines that we talked about here where we're crossing multiple strings. With a single sweep. You will undoubtedly have seen like novice guitar players do this thing. Where, you know, this note exists, this note exists, everything in between is kind of huh, huh, huh. And it's not that they're not articulating the notes, it's that there's no sense of those notes having any kind of place in time, so to speak. So it can be a little easier to lose your time feel with the economy picking thing. However, that said, with that in mind, I personally, this might be an unpopular opinion, I feel like the time feel thing is sometimes a little overstated. Occasionally, I feel like in certain styles of music, it's, or for certain aesthetics, let's say, it's important to have a very rigid bop, 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 bop time feel. I don't think it's always the right choice. I think there are times when just floating with your time can be a very cool effect. I think as long as you're making that decision from an artistic perspective and not from a perspective of I can only do one, then you're golden. But even then, how do I know? I don't know what your artistic intention is. I just know if what you're playing sounds cool. So if you're playing stuff that floats over the bar, it sounds cool. That is one disadvantage. One disadvantage that people will talk about that I don't think is true is the idea that it's alternate picking somehow sounds more aggressive than economy picking, or it sounds more articulate than economy picking. I don't think that's true. I don't think economy picking has a sound. I don't think alternate picking has a sound. I think picking has a sound, and that's it. I think there are two sounds you can make on the guitar. There is the sound of a plectrum, and there is a sound of a piece of meat attached to a human. And that's it. I feel like you can make those two sounds and no more. So an example of this with picking would be, are you doing legato notes or hybrid picking notes, which are the sound of skin on guitar, or are you picking the note, which is the sound of plectrum? And I think beyond that, I mean, really, real quick, I'm going to play something, and I'm going to try and disguise. Disguise my picking hand. Hopefully, you wouldn't have been able to tell that that was alternate picking to start and then economy picking halfway through. I'll do it again. Could you hear the switch? Interesting. Let me know in the comments if you could hear the switch from one to the other. Could you hear me change from alternate picking to economy picking? Could you hear it? If you think you could, you couldn't, because it was economy picking all the way through. Sometimes we listen with our eyes or listen with our ears. Here's another example. I'll actually do it this time. Here's alternate picking. Here's economy picking. Sounds the same. Sounds totally the same to my ear. I don't think there's anything in that, personally. I think what happens is, because economy picking doesn't require as much effort, people maybe don't put as much effort in. But you can play loud with economy picking, and you can play soft with alternate picking. I don't think the dynamic thing is a disadvantage. But timing is definitely a consideration. And I think beyond that, it's preference. Some people are going to find certain things easier than others, and you can construct entire styles around this without ever having to learn one of the others, which is pretty cool, to be fair. It's nice and enabling, I think, let's say. Okay, Six String Jim has a question. It says, do you find your first finger and thumb need to move a bit when picking like this, or is it strictly just wrist movement? Yeah, there is a bit of movement of the finger and thumb. It's not a deliberate movement, but it does happen. I think people get very caught up in the idea of picking movements being strictly one thing or another. Like, is it strictly wrist? Is it strictly rotation? Is it strictly fingers? It's rarely, very rare, when the human body moves, that only one joint moves and the others are fixed in place. That is highly, highly rare, to the point where we have entire schools of bodybuilding training, which is around just moving one joint. But I'm a hobbyist powerlifter, so I have no truck with that stuff. We move everything all of the time. I'm joking. Kidding. So anyway, especially for Doreen Yates in the comments. So how do we get onto that? That's not what this stream is about at all. Anyway, so yeah, there is a bit of movement. Another thing that I find which is interesting with this sort of stuff is there is sometimes a little bit of a change in the position of the right hand thumb to accommodate for the angle of the pick on the string. Because when you have this approach right here, I'll just, Six String Jim, I'm just going to hide your comment real quick. When you have this position of the pick on the string, in fact, I can do it like this. We'll do it on the main cam, where we have the downstrokes escaping. The angle of the pick on the string changes based on the angle of the right hand. Let me just show you the right hand cam. So this is the downward pick slanting thing. Here's the upward pick slanting thing. Don't think you can really see it terribly well there, but what's going on? I'm getting a slightly different tone with each different pick slant because the angle of the pick on the string is slightly different. So what most players will do is they'll just adjust this by ear. They'll adjust it by instinct. So there may be a slight difference in the thumb angle. That's totally fine. I don't think there's anything wrong with that. It's generally just a tone thing. It's trying to keep the tone the same. So more questions. Interesting here. Timothy Appling says, my habit is regular picking and have to concentrate to do the economy way, especially with the new lick or scale. With practice, economy picking might be easier. Hey, maybe. Maybe it will be. There are players out there who never use economy picking, by the way. Don't feel like you have to do this stuff, right? There is no rule that says you have to do strict alternate picking or strict economy picking, one or the other. You don't have to be the master of every style of picking to be a complete guitar player. You can just use one. You can use some blend of strategies that works for you, as long as you're able to play whatever lines that you want to play with a pick, i.e. if you want to be able to play, this is assuming you even want to be able to play picking lines. Some, you might be content never doing complicated picking lines, and that's totally fine. Like, was Chuck Berry a worse guitar player for not having really crazy alternate picking chops? Probably not. I don't think so. Is David Gilmour? Nope, absolutely not. You may never want to do this stuff, but if you do want to do this stuff and you do want to play lines using a pick, remember that there is no sound associated with any one of these picking strategies. It's just a way of executing lines using a plectrum. And that's all it is. So it's a question of finding one that works for you and kind of drilling into that. So by all means, experiment with economy picking, and it may become better for you. You may find it's a better strategy. Here's another little thing, though. If you do experiment with economy picking, your alternate picking will become better. Not because there's any unique benefit to doing economy picking, but because of the principle of variation in practice. We've talked about this before, but when you vary your practice, you use variations such as playing lines with economy picking, playing lines starting a different pick stroke. That's the way we learn skills. We develop skills through solving motor problems. So by challenging yourself to do the economy picking thing, even if you never use it, your alternate picking might be better for it. It's interesting. Strange things, I'm not sure if it's because I've just woken up and struggling to keep up with the pace of this lesson in real time. Apologies, strings and things. It was a bit of a breakneck one, but we had a lot to get through. So feel free to watch this on the replay and digest this at your leisure. However, if you want to take advantage of that half price offer, you have 1 hour to do it. So if you want to do that first and then come and watch the replay. It'll still be here when you come back. Okay, David Yates says, one thing I find tricky mentally is coming from three notes on two strings to four notes on two strings and back to three notes on the last two strings. Oh, referring to this exercise, yeah. Yeah, that is a very tricky thing to do because we're essentially changing the... we're changing what's going on with the right hand, where we like to find these little smooth patterns that work really well with the left hand too. So it's why you see a lot of people do lines like this. It's basically just a roll of this hand. This hand locks into a particular pattern. Oh, fluff the last note, but apart from that, it locks into this particular pattern. It feels nice and easy. The variation can be challenging, especially trying to keep time, but hey, it's going to make you a better player if you practice this stuff. So I agree, you're not wrong for finding that challenging. That is a challenging thing to do. So anyway, here we go. Joel Hume says, do you find people that use economy picking find inside picking easier, while alternate pickers find outside picking easier, referring to the Paul Gilbert lick? Now. I don't know about the last bit, but the first bit about people who do economy picking find inside picking easier, I have very much found that to be the case. And it's purely because, I think, it's purely because we are practiced in doing inside picking. Here's another thing. Inside picking generally favors like a directional approach to pick slanting. So if I'm playing, let's pick a line that's going to be like an inside picking type line. Joel, I'm just going to hide your question real quick so you can see what's going on with the pick hand. So I might do something like this. Let's just do another symmetrical lick. So that's a line that uses outside picking. If I play it with an inside pick, somehow I ended up outside picking again there. Oh, you know what? It doesn't really work. It's outside and outside. So if I go like this, whereas with an inside pick, yeah, I find that significantly easier personally, but I feel like the inside-outside picking thing is kind of a red herring personally. Again, this is something Troy Grady's talked about, and he's really the source for this stuff. He's decoded all of this for us, and now we're just trying to, you know, get guitar players using this language. I mean, this is something that happens in the strength and conditioning community all the time. You have like a researcher who'll break a new concept, or just science in general. You'll have a researcher breaks a new concept, and then, you know, it kind of filters its way through to the community at large. But for some reason, when we do this in music, people get this idea that, no, that's this person's idea and nobody should ever talk about it, which is definitely not the case. Spoken to Troy about this too. He would love people to start using this language. So anyway, what was I saying? Outside picking, inside picking, it's a little bit of a red herring, but I think there is something to it. I feel like if you're an economy picking player primarily, you've just had more exposure to doing inside picking movements than you have outside picking movements. But I don't think it's more difficult inherently in the long run. Just think that's generally where people's biases tend to fall. So yeah, that's an interesting point. And I can absolutely see that. So, got some people's picking strategies going on here. Strings and Things says, alternate picking is what I've worked on hard to date. Keen to try economy. Try it, right? You might find that it's just a couple of economy picking lines that filter their way into your playing, or some lines like the Eric Johnson lick, for example. This, let's do it again, but actually hold the pick. Very hard to play using alternate picking. Joe Bonamassa does a pretty good job of this, although he actually has some tricks, some little facets that are more Yngwie than maybe he lets on. And he certainly doesn't play these lines like Eric Johnson. He plays them in a different fashion to Eric Johnson. Richie Kotzen, when he used to use a pick even, would play them in a different fashion as well. So you may find there's certain lines like that that are really useful to have economy picking in your toolkit for, or even just trying to fit some of these kind of like the kind of, let's say, like these 3-1-3 type lines. They're very easy to do with economy picking, or this, that sort of thing. Economy picking works really well for that stuff, even if it's not your default you'll find it useful. But even if you never use it, it'll reinforce your alternate picking because of the way skill learning works. So yeah, give it a go, my man. Hopefully you'll get some good use out of that. David Yates said, I went down the route of the Ingwe a couple of years ago. I think that's a joke Chris Brooks made, and it tickled me. I'm like, yeah, the Ingwe. I'm sure somebody's used that before, but I haven't heard it. So hey, tip of the hat to Chris Brooks. Fine guitar player and fine educator as well. More than fine, outrageously good. Anyway, so the Petrucci and Gambale methods are very challenging to my strict downward pick slant. Yeah, I mean, there will be. But that's okay because, you know, we challenge ourselves, we get better at playing the guitar. That's how it works. So I can totally see how that'd be the case, but stick with it. You'll hopefully get some really cool stuff out of it. Our friend Adrian has said, question for picking strategy. Once you get comfortable with the motion at a reasonable speed, how do you pass your current max? I always get frustrated diminishing returns. Okay. Diminishing returns are always going to be a thing when you're pushing the limits of a skill. So this is true in everything. So diminishing returns is true. For those who don't know the law of diminishing returns, as far as we're talking about here, basically means that the better you get at something, the slower your progress becomes. But as long as you're still making progress, I think you're golden. Two things to bear in mind with this. First of all, there will always be variability in performance from day to day and session to session. So in the early stages of learning a skill, progress is usually quite linear. And you just get better every session. But as you start to get more and more skilled at something, there will be days where you just don't have it. And there are days where you really, really have it. What I would suggest is finding a pace or finding, if we're talking just about speed, finding a pace where you can play something not comfortably, but reasonably accurately. So it would be something we call a challenge zone. So it's a speed where things are difficult and they could come apart if you take your eye off the ball. So if you're not concentrating, it could fall to pieces, but it doesn't feel awful. It's not like, oh, I can't really play this at all. You can play, if we take the Paul Gilbert lick, for example, let's say I was playing at this pace. That's fine. That's still pretty fine. That's getting to a point where it's challenging. So if I'm not careful about that, I'm still talking to you guys a little bit, if I'm not careful about that, you can hear it starting to just come apart at the seams. That's a good place to practice because that is a place where I'm actually challenging myself to develop this skill of playing this stuff. So finding that and staying in that practice spot where it's challenging, and even if that changes from day to day, that's fine. So it might be like 200 BPM one day, it might be 190 BPM the next day, it might be 210 the day after that, who knows. If you stay in that challenge zone and practice consistently there, that's a good way to break this this kind of plateau if you're in one or whatever. So let's keep going. We've got a few more questions. Wow. Quarantunes in and out of tune. That's a great username. Find it hard to keep rhythm going using the Gambale style. Down is easier. I lean towards two-way slant, except for two notes per string when it's downward pick slant. You've described my picking strategy in a nutshell, my man. That is exactly what I do. I lean towards the Gambale style, but then I have this blues mode that I'll go into where it's time to play. Until I've been warmed up that stuff. When I'm playing that sort of stuff, I'll go deliberately into this downward two notes per string pick slant. So yeah, you're absolutely right, my man. And also, fine username you have there. David Yates says, is economy picking an evolution from gypsy jazz picking? It's similar. Now, a misconception about gypsy jazz picking is that it's economy picking. It's not really. What it is you would write it out the same way as economy picking. But with gypsy jazz, you start every string with a down pick, but it's not the same as economy picking. So if we took a line like this, let's say, let's take a line that has three notes and then one note and then three notes. So maybe I play this, which is a sus2 arpeggio, rather an ad9 arpeggio. Now, I'm just going to get rid of your comment here real quick, David. The way that I would play that as an economy picker is I would play down, up, down, and then I would sweep the next two notes. Now, that is, again, that's the way I would do that as an economy picker. A gypsy jazz guitar player, like a legit gypsy jazz guitar player, would play down, up, down, and then separate individual downstrokes. Watch this. as opposed to this. That's a gypsy way of playing it. This is the economy pick. So it's written the same way. It's written the same way. But in gypsy style, you would do a down pick, like a distinct pull back from the string and down pick. It wouldn't be a rest stroke. You would do that on every new string. So that makes it really quite tough, but it does make it really loud. It's loud, 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 loud. And that's what you want from gypsy guitar, because McAfee's are these kind of like big gypsy jazz, kind of like jazz boxes. They're not super loud, and you're normally playing with drums sometimes, or you're playing with an upright bass or fiddles, all these instruments that are really loud, and you're the quietest instrument on stage. So that's where this really aggressive digging in kind of sound came from, and that's where the gypsy thing differs from the economy picking thing. But it's a fine observation, my man. Fine observation. Okay, here we go. Steve has found the Gambale style easiest of them all. Interesting. Probably easiest to transition to from using a primarily a more legato style. You know, I don't know if that's true, but it's definitely been true for me. I came from primarily a legato style, and then I started doing more of the economy picking type thing because I found that a little easier, and then I found my way getting into the alternate picking thing. So yeah, there probably is something to that. I would suggest, I don't think it's anything magical about this style in particular. It could just be your preferences, but there's definitely a coincidence going on there, where, you know, I had this thing of coming from being a legato primarily player to an economy type player. So yeah, definitely something in that. I don't know if that's true for everyone. I wouldn't be bold enough to make that statement, but it's definitely something that I found. Although, by contrast, a bunch of people are saying, saying the opposite is true, saying it makes no difference, and you're probably right. So anyway, here we go. Let's see. Jack R says, alternate picking with swipe notes can sound a tiny bit more percussive, but I think it's so slight it don't make a difference. We haven't even touched on swiping yet. Swiping's a really interesting approach where essentially you get an outside picking type stroke without changing your pick slant, just literally by battering through the strings. So for those of you who don't know, a swipe, if I play this, if I play down, up, down on the D string, and then I wanted to play up on the G string without playing, without changing my pick slant, sticking with a strict downward pick slant like this, that would strictly be, it wouldn't be possible without doing something like this. Eared among you might hear that as what I'm doing there is essentially I'm just playing almost like the last note on the string as like a double stop, like the smoke and the water double stops, but I'm playing it with the G string muted. So when I'm striking the D and G string at the same time, you only really hear the D string. Now, I find this a little bit difficult because it's quite tiring having to play through those two strings. But yeah, swiping is an interesting thing. And as Jack has rightly pointed out, it can sound pretty percussive. I think it's just personally, here's the deal. I think personally, and this is conjecture, Jack, but I think the reason it sounds more percussive is because you have to be very physical. You have to be very aggressive to make the swiping thing work. Otherwise, it just doesn't happen. Because you have to put a lot of force in to get through those strings. So maybe that's it. Maybe it's just that swiping makes you pick a little harder because you have to, I think, personally. Blue Summon with a great question. What date do the live streams return because of Christmas and New Year? Blue Summon, they're not going away. The Gregorian calendar has given us New Year's Day. Yeah, it's given us Monday streams on the 27th and then the 3rd. So we'll still be streaming. We'll still be here. We don't take time off. It's not how musicians work. So yeah, we'll keep going. Here we go. Timothy Appling says, I learn something new every time I watch your live stream. I feel like the only way to get better is watch or play with someone who's better than me and practice, practice, practice. Oh, very kind of you. Thank you very much. Timothy, you're absolutely right. It's difficult to find musicians in the middle of a global pandemic. So yeah, hanging out with musicians who maybe have a little more miles on them is very much It's very much the move. It's the thing to do. Here we go. Timothy Appling. Oh, Jackass is at Timothy Appling. It looks like string hopping to me, but he makes it work. Oh, this is referring to Frank Gambale, referring to Frank Zappa, even. Yeah, Frank had a really interesting style with this kind of thing right here. String hopping is a really interesting thing. Incidentally, by the way, if you guys aren't familiar with that, that's one of the concepts that Troy Grady's talked about. We talked about it briefly in one of our previous streams. I think it was the John Petrucci stream. About the idea that this movement, even though we're playing down and up, it's not really alternate picking because we're not alternating the actual movements that we're doing. Again, that was eye-opening for me when I found out about that stuff. So there you go, guys. I am going to leave you there. Thank you so much for joining us. It has been a total blast. We are now 8 minutes past the hour, so we have 52 minutes left of our GI Plus annual membership. So if you want to join GI Plus, you want to get access to a bunch of lessons like this. I'm just planning so much stuff for the new year. There's going to be so much crazy new content going up like literally weekly on GI Plus. And we also have a bunch of new contributors coming in. I've got this great slide guitar player. He's coming to teach you about that. We have some courses on ear training coming up. We're going to be covering all manner of stuff for all styles, all ability levels. If you want to get better at playing the guitar, GI Plus is the place to do it. And we'll be running a 50% discount on the annual membership for 1 hour after this stream. Links will be in the comments. So you can find it. Let's see. You can find it right here. Oh, nope, that's the wrong one. Let me find the right comment. You can find it right here. So if you're watching this on YouTube, get there. That is the offer. It is bit.ly/GI+_half_price. Yep, get on that. You can get your half price annual membership. It will be finished at 10 o'clock GMT, and that's it, gone. So if you're watching this in the replay, apologies. I don't want to say snoozy lose because that's a bit mean. But I'm going to play for you guys a little bit and then we'll call it there. But yes, I will see you guys in 1 week's time. Have a great Christmas. Eat lots of food. Play lots of guitar. Hope Santa is good to you. Thank you so much for having me. My name is Nick Jennison. I'm going to doodle a little bit on this backing track because it's great fun. So I will see you guys on the flip side. Have a really great holidays, however you choose to celebrate. And I'll see you guys on the flip. 27th, we'll be here Monday night. And don't forget, 50% off GI, 50% off GI Plus memberships. Let's do this. I need the drums so we can hear what's going on. Enjoy yourselves. Lots of food, lots of guitar playing. I'll see more of the same on the 27th. My name is Nick Jennison, and it's a pleasure to introduce to you GI Plus, the brand new lesson platform brought to you by Guitar Interactive. We've assembled a team of the best players and educators in the world to bring you exclusive lessons covering everything from metal to blues to fusion and everything in between. Want to level up your shred chops? Check out How to Play Fast by Andy James. Or how about Sweet Picking with Rick Graham? Or maybe country's more your bag. Well, how about a full-length exclusive country guitar course from Andy Wood? Interested in learning how to play over changes? Well, members get access to hours of exclusive lessons from Fusion Maestro Tom Quayle. Or maybe you want your playing to sound more soulful? Well, who better than Chris Buck to show you how it's done? Or perhaps you want to learn the secrets of the masters? Well, members get access to over 60 feature-length tech sessions where our tutors painstakingly decode the styles of players like David Gilmour, Eddie Van Halen, John Petrucci, Larry Carlton, Tosin Abasi, Paul Gilbert, and many more. You get all this along with exclusive live webinars, free backing tracks, competitions, and so much more. So what are you waiting for? Sign up for GI Plus today.